there are three ways that God deals with us and our problems. One approach is God prevents any problem or certain problem coming in our life. Second approach is God allows a problem to come into our life, but He helps us to overcome the problem so we get out victorious. The third one is problems come. We are not victorious over problems, but God helps us to go through problems and never to leave Him. If we go to 2 Chronicles chapter 17, verse 6, we read that Jehoshaphat was a good king. And verse 10 tells us that God protected him from his enemies, so no problems. In chapter 17, God protected Jehoshaphat, so he didn't have problems. When we come to chapter 20, we read that God allowed the enemies to come, and we read in verse 1, after this, the Moabites and the Ammonites with some of the Meunites came to make war on Jehoshaphat. So God could prevent this from happening, like He did in chapter 17. But this time He didn't. He allowed problems to come. But God protected them in a different way. So when God allows problems in our life to come, enemies to come, what should we do? I think we should do what Jehoshaphat did. Verse 3. Alarm Jehoshaphat resolved to inquire to the Lord, and he proclaimed a fast from all Judah. When our lives are threatened, faith is threatened, marriage, morality of our children, fire for worship is threatened, or whatever Satan does to threaten us, first thing that we should do is an earnest prayer. We should pray to God. If only we could learn to pray the way Jehoshaphat prayed in verses 6 to 12. Let's read only verse 6. O Lord, God of our fathers, are you not the God who is in heaven? You rule over all the kingdoms of the nations. Power and might are in your hands, and no one can withstand you. Let's learn to pray like this. Even when we are in despair and fear is making our inside melt, let's ascribe sovereign power to God. When you begin praying in this way, strength and hope and confidence will appear in your life, and you will feel the touch of the ruler of the universe, of God Himself. And then we read that Jehoshaphat remembers what God did for them in the past. So he is referring to the history of the Israelites. Verse 7. O our God, did you not drive out the inhabitants of this land before your people Israel and gave it forever to the descendants of Abraham, your friend? Often we forget what God did for us in our life, and we only concentrate on the problem that is in front of us. But when we remember what God did for us in the past, and I'm not talking what He did for people in the Bible, I'm talking for us personally, this is going to give us strength to go through the new problem. In verses 10 and 11, we are going to read them. Now Jehoshaphat describes what is actually happening right now in his life. So he is talking about Moabites and Ammonites, people that came to fight against him. And then in verse 12, he pleads for help. And he says, you know, we are helpless. So let's read verse 12. O our God, we do not judge them, for we have no power to face this vast army that is attacking us. We do not know what to do, but our eyes are upon you. So Jehoshaphat does things that we should do when we have problems. We should pray to God, acknowledge that He is Almighty, remember what He did for us in the past, and say, God, this is my problem. Please do something. In response to this, God sends a prophet, and he tells them that God will protect them. Verses 15 and 17. He said, listen, King Jehoshaphat, and all who live in Judah and Jerusalem. This is what the Lord says to you. Do not be afraid or discouraged because of this vast army, for the battle is not yours, but God's. Verse 17. You will not have to fight this battle. Take up your positions, stand firm, and see the deliverance that the Lord will give you. O Judah and Jerusalem, do not be afraid, do not be discouraged. Go out to face them tomorrow, and the Lord will be with you. So, Jehoshaphat has cried out to God, and he said, we are powerless, please help us. And God's response was, fear not, the battle is... What did he say? The battle is mine. The battle is mine. And Jehoshaphat's response, verse 18, he bowed down with his face to the ground, and all the people of Judah and Jerusalem fell down to worship before the Lord. And then something happened, and I would like to concentrate on this part. Not on the first part when he prayed. Not because prayer is not important, but because I would like to concentrate on the second part. So when we have problems, we should pray, but there is second thing that we should do as well. Verse 19. Then some Levites from the Kohathites and Korathites stood up and praised the Lord, the God of Israel, with a very loud voice. Was this just a spontaneous response to everything? Who are these people? First Chronicles, so we will come back to Second Chronicles chapter 20. Let's go to First Chronicles chapter 6. First Chronicles chapter 6, verses 31 to 33, first part. First Chronicles chapter 6, 31 to 33, first part. These are the men David put in charge of the music in the house of the Lord after the ark came to rest there. They ministered with music before the tabernacle, the tent of meeting, until Solomon built the temple of the Lord in Jerusalem. They performed their duties according to the regulations laid down for them. Here are the men who served together with their sons from the Kohathites, and then it goes on and on and mentions the names. So, who are the Kohathites? They are the musicians in the temple. They are the choir of Israel. Since the time of David, this group and a few others were leading the singing and worship in the temple. So they stood up in front of everybody. Everybody was bowing down. We read in verse 18, so we are back to 2 Chronicles chapter 20, verse 18. So everybody is bowed down and worshiping God, and they stood up in front of everyone, and they start singing. They start praising the Lord. After this great time of worship in response to God's promises, the people are now, you know, ready to meet the enemies. They rise early and they head into the wilderness. And in verse 20, we read well-known verse, 2 Chronicles chapter 20, verse 20, where Jehoshaphat commands them to trust God's promise. Chapter 20, verse 20. Early in the morning, they left for the desert of Tekoa. As they stood out, Jehoshaphat stood and said, "Listen to me, Judah and people of Jerusalem. Have faith in the Lord your God, and you will be upheld. Have faith in his prophets, and you will be successful." So Jehoshaphat appoints his frontline troops. Who are they? The best soldiers? Yes? No. The singers. What are they going to do? Use their flute and whatever is in their head and beat the enemies? What is Jehoshaphat's tactic of winning the battle? No. God said that the battle is his. So they don't have to fight. They meet the enemies with song of victory. Verse 21. After consulting the people, Jehoshaphat appointed men to sing to the Lord and to praise him for the splendor of his holiness as they went out at the head of the army, saying, "Give thanks to the Lord, for his love endures forever." When God tells us that the battle is his, that the victory is sure, we should meet our enemies. We should meet our problems with songs of thanks. So you have a problem, you pray, you glorify God for his sovereignty, you remember the past and what he did in the past for you, and then you tell God, "This is my problem, please do something." What is the next thing that you should do? Sing. Sing and glorify God to songs of thanksgiving. Not songs of lamenting. No. Songs of thanksgiving. Although the victory belongs to God, means through which God gives victory is song. And in this case is the choir. They go first, not really to fight, but to thank God for promising that he is going to fight for them. The defeat was so great that it took them, in verse 22, 3 days to collect all the things. And let's read verse 22. As they began to sing and praise, the Lord set ambush against the men of Ammon and Moab and Mount Seir, who were invading Judah, and they were defeated. As they begin to sing and praise. Yes, they prayed first. They did pray. So we should not skip the prayer. But how frequently we pray and forget to sing. So when you have a problem, and you pray and you finish praying, how many times do you start singing? If you're honest, we don't really do that. But this is how they defeated the enemies, with prayer and singing. And it says, as they begin to sing and praise, the enemies were defeated. So, songs, hymns, are not just to thank God for promising to defeat our problems. It is here to defeat our problems. Of course, not song on its own. It is God that is going to do it. Spiritual warfare should be carried out with prayer and singing. And we so frequently forget singing. In verse 19, when all the people fell down to worship, the choir stood up and sing. In verse 21, when people went out to meet the enemies, the choir went before them with songs of victory. Spiritual warfare should be carried out with prayer and singing. In verse 22, when they start singing, the enemies were thrown into confusion by the songs of God's people. Or to put it in another way, God has appointed the use of spiritual songs as a weapon against our enemy and against our problems. So this is the Old Testament story where God used song. Okay, when they started with the prayer, when God used song to defeat the enemies. Do we have any New Testament story when God used, okay, firstly prayer, but song to defeat the problems? Acts chapter 16. Paul and Silas, they were not protected from the problem, from their enemies. They were, however, spared from death. In Acts chapter 16, we are going to read verses 22 to 24. It says that they were stripped of their clothes, they were beaten, and then thrown into the prison. Now, picture this. You are walking down the high street and suddenly a group of people attack you. They strip off your clothes, they take their wooden clubs and they beat you for 15 minutes. And then you are thrown into a prison. And your hands are put into iron. So now you have an idea what Paul and Silas went through. In the middle of night, they had no idea what tomorrow is going to happen. If they're going to be hanged, beheaded, flogged again, no idea. What are they doing? They are praying. That's right. We would do the same. We would pray. But this is not all what they are doing. Acts chapter 16, verse 25. About midnight, Paul and Silas were praying and singing hymns to God. And the other prisoners were listening to them and saying, they are cuckoo. You know, something is wrong with them. I guess some of them were saying that. Okay, so they were praying. Yes, we would do that. But they were, after they finished praying, they were singing. It was midnight. They didn't have any pain, right? I don't think so. They were in pain, exhausted. They were pleading for God to save them, to help them. And then they start singing. If somebody would say to you, when you hit the bottom, you should start singing, you would probably tell him, obviously you have never hit the bottom. That's why you say this. But Paul and Silas, they did hit the bottom. With Jehoshaphat, it was different. Yeah, they were afraid of enemies. But here, they hit the bottom. They were beaten and thrown into a prison. And they didn't know tomorrow if they're going to be executed. Why were they singing? They have learned that they should pray, but also that they should sing and thank God for delivering them. Singing to God is not merely a response to His grace. Paul and Silas have learned that singing is a spiritual weapon. They have learned, like Jehoshaphat and many of us, that our enemies, our problems, are going to be thrown into confusion by songs, by prayer and songs. But today I'm emphasizing songs. What did God do for Paul and Silas? The same thing as He did for Jehoshaphat. Acts chapter 16, verse 26. Suddenly after what? After when they start singing. Suddenly, there was such a violent earthquake that the foundations of the prison were shaken. At once, all the prison's door flew open and everybody's chains came loose. We see this again. God accepts praise and makes occasion for His power. God has appointed spiritual song as an effective weapon against our problems. Ephesians chapter 5, verses 19 and 20. Ephesians chapter 5, verses 19 and 20. Speak to one another with psalms, hymns, and spiritual songs. Sing and make music in your heart to the Lord, always giving thanks to God the Father for everything, in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. So when we meet, what should we do? We should speak to one another and we should sing. Singing. We tend to forget the importance of singing. We should fight the devil, we should fight our problems with the Word of God and with the songs. No wonder that Satan hates the songs of God's people, and he tries to keep us from singing. He tries us from being a singing person or singing church. Satan cannot endure when God's people with true heart start singing, because he knows that the most powerful weapon to fight him or our problems is prayer and songs. And he wants us to stop praying, and he wants us to stop singing. In the story, in the book of Acts, not only that physical walls came down, we see that emotional walls, spiritual walls, came down. The prison guard, he was not a believer, he did not follow Jesus. What did happen? When they start praying and when they start singing, and he was listening to all of this, he experienced, he felt the presence of God, and he went stand down. He bowed down in front of God. Through their prayer and praise and worship, his eyes opened and he could see God's sovereignty. He could see true God. Praise and worship is able to break every chain, to set every captive free, heal every wound. Through praise and worship, we are able to overcome the obstacles in our lives, witness to the unbelievers, and most of all, to glorify God. One pastor was called one late night to one apartment, and there was a group of young women. They were praying for one lady to be set free from a demon possession. So he went there, and for 2 hours he was reading the Bible, he was preaching, and nothing happened. She was violent, she would knock out the Bible, scream, and you know. At one point, somebody starts singing one familiar hymn, and then other people in the room start join her, and they start singing. And they sang that song again and again and again. And this demon-possessed lady, she began to tremble. She threatened them if they don't stop singing. She was thrown on the floor. She was screaming for Satan not to leave her. And then she went into convulsions, went limp. When she became conscious, she could not remember anything that has happened, but she was willing to read the Bible and to pray, because the demon has left. Pastor was preaching and praying for 2 hours and ladies before he came. But when they start singing, the devil has left. The demon has left. So prayer and singing is very powerful weapon. And today we are studying about specifically prayer. Songs to God is not little emotional, thing that is going to spice up a worship. So it's going to be nice. It is very powerful, strong weapon against the devil and our problems. Jehoshaphat, Paul, and Silas have learned this. This pastor has also realized the power of prayer, of song. What about us? Are we going to remember and learn and realize that there is power in songs? Songs that glorify God. Yes, we should not stop praying. Prayer is very powerful. We should continue praying. But we should add to our prayer songs. Songs that glorify God. Because Jehoshaphat, Paul and Silas has experienced when they start singing, immediately the enemies were defeated. So two applications. First, use songs in your personal, family, devotional life or in the church. It will bring a new power to fight whatever you are fighting. Satan cannot bear the singing of the saints. You can drive him away with songs. And don't fall for a trap saying, oh, you cannot sing. There are only some people that can sing. Everybody can sing. There is a difference. Not everybody can perform, but everybody can sing. Not everybody can lead in singing. Not everybody can read the music. Not everybody can stay on the right keys. But everybody can sing. God loves to hear your songs, no matter how badly you sing. And remember, woe to your enemies and your problems when you, with sincere heart, you start praying and singing. Woe to your enemies. Second point. The ministry of song is a warfare. It's not just something to make our worship nice. Yes, it does make our service nice. But not just that. There is a power in a song. It is a warfare. God has ordained the gifted singers to be appointed as spiritual leaders in the choir. And we read that David has appointed some Levites to lead out in this ministry of music and to serve in the temple. It seems these days there is not enough emphasis in many churches on praise and worship. Okay, let's sing a few hymns and that's it. I think that we should put more emphasis on music. In this church, we do put emphasis on prayer, which is good. But I think that we should put even more, on the top of emphasis on prayer, we should put emphasis on music. The book of Psalms is the shortest book in the Bible. Correct?
No.
No. It's a very long book. Very long book. And what are psalms? Songs, hymns. Why do we have them? Also that we could read them. Well, you know, they were not just reading them, they were singing them. Today we read psalms, when actually it would be nice if we could sing them. Because that's what they were doing. So if God taught that, you know, it's important to have a big book in the Bible with so many songs, we individually, as a family, as a church, should remember the importance of songs. And we should emphasize singing. Because there is power in the song. There is power in the prayer, but there is also power in the song. When they were singing, Jehoshaphat and the people, Paul and Silas, this pastor and those ladies in that apartment, Satan, enemies, problems were defeated. So yes, read the Bible, pray, but please don't forget to sing. There is power in song. Amen.
Amen.
Thank you, Pastor Rudi, for delivering the message of God to this church. I have some mixed ideas, mixed thoughts about this. First thought which I would like to present to the church is that indeed we are not singing enough. Especially in our homes, I'm not sure about your home, but in my home I would do with some a little bit more singing. Especially when we begin and finish and end the Sabbath, and why not every day in the morning and evening. I think that connects the family and bring you closer to God. Now, another thought which I have is that prayer. We know that the Lord is saying that if our hands are dirty of blood, not necessarily in a physical way, we have blood on our hands, but we are doing lawlessness, we are unrighteous in our lives. What is God doing with our prayers? He can't hear us. Well, He can hear us, obviously, but He turns His face away. In many cases, this is the case. God will not cooperate with a man which is presuming, like we were saying in the Sabbath school lesson earlier, presuming on God's love, claiming the promises, but not fulfilling the conditions on which the promise may be fulfilled in our lives. Are we sometimes presumptuous, going there on our knees, praying for some miracles in our life, for ourselves or for our spouses, for our children, for whatever situation, for our jobs? And then what do? We go back and do the same wrong things, which we know very well, because our conscience is telling us how guilty we are about that, and we make no change. So are our prayers heard or listened to or answered in the way we expect, we want? No. But when we sing, what is happening? It's nothing about ourselves when we sing, isn't that right? It's all about God. It's all about God giving Him the glory, and then, you know, He's acting. I like that. On the other hand, another thought which came to my mind is that Ellen White in her writings is saying that it's more important the prayer than the singing. And he says prayer prevails much more than singing. So we need to have a balance to think about all these things, put everything in the right perspective, and not do more singing than praying, or just forget about praying and just singing. That will get into a different extreme, and I think Brother Johnny and Chris can testify on this from their previous experience. Other denominations are focusing on the emotional part, so this is what I'm saying, the singing can lead to much emotion and less intellectual faith. Yeah. So yeah, I think yes, we definitely need more singing the hymns to God. And you know what? Another benefit of it is that when we'll have a choir here, we'll be more people singing. Why? Because they practice the songs at home, and the choir will be more rich. And one more thought. Throughout the Bible, we can see how the angels of God in heaven, they are singing, and they are magnifying the name of the Lord in heavens by their singing. It's a common practice in heaven. So if we want to be part of that community, a holy community in heaven, surely we need to get accustomed to singing much. So thank God for the message we received today. And as we close this worship service, we'll stand up and sing the hymn number 294, Power in the Blood. Let's all stand up.
Let's pray. Our Heavenly Father, thank you that we could study your word. Thank you for the prayer, but also thank you for the songs and hymns. Please help us to realize that there is power in your word, that there is power in the prayer, but also there is power in songs. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Amen.